My name is Lori Suter, and as a conservation ambassador for Save the Elephants, an organization in Kenya that is securing a future for elephants and communities who live with them, I am delighted to introduce this morning's second panel, which will explore the importance of mobilizing ideas to create global impact. Innovative ideas often stem from personal experiences. Each of our speakers has had a unique journey which has inspired the development of their respective projects. Digital platforms have revolutionized the ability to connect people, share experiences, and raise global awareness to create impact. From immersive experiences that transform viewers into participants, to empowering Muslim girls and connecting bereaving teens, to digital campaigns for HIV/AIDS advocacy, digital platforms are powerful vehicles for storytelling. Today's panelists will offer insight on how digital platforms and social media are improving livelihoods and making impact. I hope you had a chance to see our speakers' bios on the screens, but please allow me to highlight a few of their additional achievements. Amani Al-Khatahtbeh is the founder and editor-in-chief of Muslim Girl, the leading Muslim women's blog in the US, which she founded at the age of 17. She's an author and has been featured on the Forbes 30 Under 30 list and various media outlets, including the New York Times and The Guardian. Gabo Arora is creative director and senior advisor at the United Nations, the first person to ever hold this title. He is also the founder and president of LightShed, a virtual reality and social impact startup. Most recently, he co-created, directed, and produced the UN's first ever virtual reality film series focusing on vulnerable populations, along with the UN's first virtual reality app. Genevieve Liu is the founder of Surviving Life After a Parent Dies, or SLAPT, as well as a senior at the University of Chicago Laboratory Schools. At 13, she created the digital platform SLAPT, which enables teens who have lost a parent to connect and share experiences. Sheila Roche is the chief creative and communications officer at RED, which works to engage the private sector and consumers in the fight against AIDS. She has conceived RED's major campaigns, including the RED Shopathon for World AIDS Day. She also serves on the Chicago Committee for Human Rights Watch and Kindling Films, and is a member of the Women and Global Development Forum Steering Committee at the Chicago Council on Global Affairs. Last but not least, our moderator, Niamh King, is the Vice President for Programs and Strategic Content at the Chicago Council on Global Affairs. Prior to joining the council, she held positions with Intel, the European Commission, FAS, and the United Nations International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia. Returning back to this morning's panel, we will begin a flash talk presentation by Gabo Arora, followed by a panel discussion with the speakers. And following on from this first panel, we will continue to take questions both from the stage as well as through our online survey application. The link is currently displayed on the screen. If you have an internet-enabled device, please type chi.cnf.io directly into your browser and select today's program. Thank you. It was an honor to introduce today's esteemed panel.
Hi. Good morning. Thanks for having me. It's an honor to be here and be invited at such an esteemed gathering. It's going to be a very quick talk, mainly to just get you to understand that what virtual reality is and that some great work has been done. We've been fortunate to be a part of a really great team to do some great work on virtual reality at the UN. Virtual reality, for those of you who don't know, is being discussed as something that's going to be as revolutionary as the internet itself or mobile phones. It's supposed to be the next big wave, and it's really great to kind of share here a little bit of what we've been able to do the past couple of years with VR. So UNICEF usually is a great organization, and they do face-to-face fundraising. And usually they don't have virtual reality goggles. They just have people who will stop you on the streets in 40 different countries. And that's one of their biggest sources of gaining funds for the world's children. We've outfitted them with a 4-minute version of Clouds Over Sidra, the UN's first film, which I was a part of, that gives people an exposure to a crisis they wouldn't otherwise. The great thing was, just to give you a little bit of analysis, this has doubled donations for UNICEF consistently in 40 different countries. Usually 1 in 12 people will give if they're stopped. If they have a little bit of an experience, 1 in 6 people donated. So it's awesome. It's great. We're really proud of it. But I just want to go through a little bit about the philosophical way, because when I show that to people, they just think, great, everybody just stick your stories into virtual reality and we're going to double donations. But there's a philosophical approach, and a lot of it, you know, usually the bigger talk that I give is called Representing the Pain of Others, and it's alluding to Susan Sontag's Regarding the Pain of Others. In it, she, and you know, I've kind of mishmashed a lot of it, she really goes through how, through different mediums, people have used, whether it's painting or photography or when we went to television, how people confronted this idea of trying to represent the pain of others or try to show the suffering of others without understanding the mediums and a lot of the things that are happening. If there's one thesis of the talk, it's not enough just to show suffering of people. And I know that's counterintuitive for a lot of people. And I think we think if we just show refugees suffering, if we just show people suffering, it's going to work. It usually doesn't. And that's usually what's interesting. But what's interesting is every new medium makes that same mistake in thinking that's what you can do. So this is one of the first pictures from the American Civil War. It's about a battlefield, and I just usually put it there to show that with photography, things become more real, and there's this need to go right into the conflict and to show what's happening. Many people would say World War I would be the first photographed war, where photography played a really amazing role in bringing these images to people's lives. Vietnam could be considered the first televised war, where you have a different new medium that's bringing in violence and war and suffering. Syria is definitely the first YouTube war, because if you go on YouTube, you're going to see horrible things. And of course, with Black Lives Matter, we had the first live murder sort of thing that people were able to see in real time. And VR, where is that going to be? I did something bad there, 1 second. I'll skip this part. Just to give you a sense, and sorry if these are a little graphic, this is from World War I, but this was published in 1930 in Germany, and it's called War Against War, and it took 40 of the worst pictures that you could imagine of World War I, and circulated everywhere in 8 different languages, many different editions, bestseller in Germany. But for many people, didn't really do anything to stop a lot of the carnage. So, you know, oh God, I don't know what that is. There we go. Okay, sorry. My apologies. Same thing, you know, with Facebook Live. I think a lot of people saw, a lot of this, and it was used in a way that I think we're making similar types of mistakes where we're saying, we're giving you full, you know, front row access to suffering, but for many people, it's not working. Why doesn't it work? I think the first sort of quick thing, this is where I have to flash my talk and move a little fast now. We grow numb to a lot of these things. And just to give you an example, this is, you know, some pictures that were quite common of how we would represent things in Ethiopia. And, you know, you can cringe now looking at them, but, you know, if you remember Sally Struthers, you remember all of that. Those type of shock value things work for a while, but then they stop working. They stop working, and the evidence of that is if you go to UNICEF's site now, you don't see pictures like that that you saw in the 80s. You see pictures that bring in a bit more storytelling, a little more context, give voice to the people you're listening to in some ways. So that makes you grow less numb, than just showing shocking pictures. I don't know if you know this, but we have a lustful relationship to violence. You go on a highway and everyone will stop to see an accident, but not maybe everyone will do something. And so just showing horrible things doesn't necessarily do the same intended thing. And you know, there's a lot of there's video games or there's Clockwork Orange or there's other sort of images that play to that and don't necessarily lead to action and impact. The third one, and it's a little provocative, it can be exploited by the enemy. Showing somebody die can make you feel bad, but the people who don't like those people feel very happy. So just showing those things is not necessarily enough, because again, it can be used. And this is the same thing that's been used in the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, when different sides will show different sorts of sufferings to motivate other people. And Susan Sontag goes very deeply into that. The same picture of Eilon that motivated a whole continent to, in Europe to try to bring in refugees was used by ISIS itself to say, this is what happens if you leave, you know? So you have to really think about how we do it. So when I did the first sort of VR films, a lot of it is within that realm. They have a very different tone. They have a very different way of dealing with it than most ways that people would think. And so this is like, a quite sort of little thing of why we think empathy works. Sensational shocking pictures killed storytelling. I always look to the Showa documentary, which is a gold standard of documentaries in the world. It uses no archival footage from the Holocaust, yet is considered one of the greatest moving pieces of work of the 20th century, because it paralyzes the imagination, and without imagination, there's no empathy. So that's what we're really trying to do. So, you can download the app. We have many films now. If any of you are at the Tribeca Film Festival in April, there's a new experience we have that's not only using VR as a mobile device, but a walk-around device, where we'll be doing an installation on, with a Holocaust survivor. So it's a very exciting time, and I just wanted to expose everybody to a little bit of the philosophy that it's not just a headset, it's not just the tech, it really is the philosophy and storytelling. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. Thanks to you all for being here. And now that Ivo's gone, I can tell you that he did actually wear the hat. He just didn't want to admit it this morning when he was out marching. I'm delighted to be here with this fantastic, fantastic panel. We are talking about mobilizing ideas and creating impact. Laurie kindly introduced them. Thank you, Laurie, for that. But let's go straight into it. As many of you know, innovative ideas often stem from personal experiences. George referenced it earlier this morning when he was talking about some of the diseases that Horizon works on and how they relate back to a lot of their employees. And everyone has a unique and defining moment that establish your respective projects. And I'd love to hear from you, Amani, please, how your personal experience has brought you to where you are now in the project that you're working on.
I think that my personal experience was really catalyzed by 9/11, which is an event that took place when I was 9 years old. It was a tragedy that rocked the nation, and it especially rocked the Muslim American community in ways that I think a lot of people have not really spoken about or delved too deeply into. But especially being a child who grew up through, the height of modern day Islamophobia, it really dramatically impacted me. It impacted my self-esteem, and we really don't talk too much about the way that things like media misrepresentation impacts, the mental health of children and their development, the development of their identities growing up. For me, I was bombarded by a lot of horrible messaging in the headlines, in the media, about what Islam is, who Muslims are, what Muslim women look like, what they believe in, what they stand for, and it was never Muslim women doing the talking. So not only was I being bombarded by this messaging, but I also never saw a reflection of myself in the media and in these conversations that were unfolding in the world around me. And really, I think that it all came to a head for me when I was a teenager. I started MuslimGirl.com out of my bedroom when I was 17 years old. I was a senior in high school, and I did so. Honestly, you know, everyone wants to hear the story where that light bulb went off and everything, but it happened because I was pissed off, you know? I was really pissed off about the way that I felt just completely alienated from my society, from my surroundings, even though I'm a Jersey girl, born and raised in New Jersey, you know? Like, this is the only life I've ever known. And so I did what any typical millennial would do that's pissed off. I went on the internet. I went on social media. And I started this blog with the intent of course, creating a platform for Muslim women's voices like mine, you know, the girls that were born and raised here, that are American just as much as they are Muslim, who need to have a voice about their experiences and what this lifestyle is like for us. But even more selfishly for me, it was because I wanted to connect with other Muslim girls that were like me, that were out there. I knew that I couldn't be alone. I knew that there had to be an entire generation of Muslim children that grew up during the exact atmosphere that I did. And so I wanted to find them. I wanted to be friends with them so that we can actually have the conversations that we needed to have and that we were not being given a space to have anywhere else.
Great, thanks. Genevieve, let's go over to you, please, with the same question.
Yeah, I mean, what she's saying is very relatable, you know, going online for help. You know, I would say that the moment, clearly, that my life took a turn was, so I'm 17 now, but when I was 13, on August 5th, 2012, my father drowned saving two boys in Lake Michigan. And I always say that, you know, at that moment, it was so surreal. I mean, parent loss at such a young age feels sort of like, you know, cliche from a movie or a storybook, you know, not something that actually happens in real life. And when it did, I really did feel the similar sense of, you know, alienation in my community that I had always really felt at home, you know, up until then. And I remember, you know, I lost my father in the summer, so quickly having to go back to school, I dreaded having to talk to my friends about it and being sort of chased down the hallway by this sort of creepy guidance counselor. I wanted to be left alone. I felt like, you know, the only person who had ever lost a parent at such a young age. But that was actually, and I think sort of this light bulb-esque moment that, you know, I can really think of was when my mom reintroduced me to this girl named Isabel, who had lost her mother to cancer in the fifth grade. And I remember when it happened in Miss Frank's class, and I remember crying when Miss Frank announced the news to my fifth grade classroom, and not because I understood what she was going through, but I really understood the gravity of what was happening. I knew that this was something that was going to change her life forever. And you know, fast forward 3 years, my mom was saying, okay, you two need to hang out and discuss what it's like. And I was mortified. Like, we were not friends. She was much more popular than me. Like, I did not want to hang out with her. But I remember sitting in my sister's room and talking. And it wasn't that we had to talk about parent loss, per se. It was kind of that, you know, we didn't have to. And for the first time, you know, talking to this other teen who had lost a parent, I sort of felt, you know, a sense of belonging and you know, the community that I needed to kind of move forward with my situation. And at that moment, it kind of clicked for me. So just like Amani, the first thing I did as soon as Isabel left was I went online and I Googled teens who had lost a parent, you know, anecdotes, stories. But, you know, I found nothing. I found medical-type research, religious-oriented articles, I mean, both of which are great things, but not what I was looking for. So at that moment, it kind of clicked to me that I wanted to create the first online community for teens who've lost a parent, like myself, you know, and the 7.4 million other teens in the United States that have also lost a parent, to sort of find one another and share their stories. So, yeah.
Thanks. And the audience, I'd like to know that Genevieve got a special dispensation to be here today because exams are on.
Oh, I'm really happy.
And she's going to Yale in the fall, so congratulations to her. Aren't they lucky to have her?
What a great excuse to get out of exams.
Sorry?
What a great excuse to get out of exams.
Oh, yeah, for real. For real.
So I'm going to now ask Sheila, whom I am quite certain did not hop on the internet, like I didn't either when we had our things that we were thinking about and our seminal moments leading us to things. So Sheila, what about you for our question on this, please?
Well, first of all, I'd like to say that I feel like a complete slacker being up here with Genevieve and Amani and starting their careers as, you know, social activists as teenagers. That was not my trajectory. So I was a rock and roll manager for almost 20 years, and I ran a management company, and our principal client was U2. And so that took up 90% of my not only my work life, but my life. So I always say, half joking, that coming up to the 20-year mark in 2004, I decided to leave to get some sleep. But actually, the sly thing that was going on in my head was, I'd really, even though I loved my clients and I was incredibly lucky to be part of this incredibly, you know, dynamic family, I really had bitten the, the advocacy and activist bug, because in my last 5 years in that job, Bono had made activism a second full-time day job, and which was a real pain in the neck for me, right? It was already very hard to get albums delivered on time. And now he was taking on another job and was like, oh, well, how is this going to work? So as the person who kind of had to drive, you know, deadlines and stuff, that was one of my roles, it was really a problem. But actually, I just started tromping around the world with him and with the activists who were involved in lobbying for the cancellation of the debts of the world's poorest countries by the year 2000. And that's what he really had kind of latched onto. And, you know, I didn't trust the activists at all. I thought these guys were going to put him out in front of the media and kind of do kind of weird stuff. And so I was really mean to them for the first year. And then after about a year, I thought, oh, these people are really amazing. And I loved what they were doing. Anyway, so I don't take up the entire panel. I'll try and fast forward. I had to leave my previous gig with no idea that they might want to use my skills, which I did not think were transferable at all in that other line of work. But so I decided to take a year off, and lo and behold, I got a call on February 16th, 2005, asking me if I would get involved with this thing called RED. And it was a really flattering call from Bono, and he said, you know, we need somebody to do X, Y, and Z, and I wonder if you can think of somebody. And I said, well, I might be able to help for a couple of months, and I heard that would be ideal, click. And so that's how I ended up being involved in RED, and I helped set up RED, the AIDS organization that he and Bobby Shriver conceived. It was their idea, but I was very lucky to be in on the ground. Thank you.
Great, and I hope everybody noticed, since it's St. Patrick's Week in Chicago, we kindly put an Irish person on every panel. thank you, Mary. Thank you, Sheila. And you have a not an all-female panel up here, so we'll move to Gabo. Gabo, what moved you into the VR UN space in your life?
Yeah, I was involved working with the Secretary General on something called the MDG Advocacy Group, the Millennium Development Goals, and it was about working with eminent people to try to get the word out. And I started in 2011, and I just saw, with the revolution of new media and everything happening, I felt that the traditional model of calling George Clooney or other celebrities, while important, and I know we work with Bono as well, and he's wonderful, we just really needed to use the power of the new technologies that are out there that could have a greater impact. And so I started working in, you know, looking at viral videos, and we worked and partnered with Humans of New York, who I think single-handedly has more followers on his blog than the entire UN system everywhere. So that's an incredible power. And so with virtual reality, it was just a natural progression to see how we could use that. And for me, it really came from, I'd have to organize heads of state who would join join the group or get involved. They'd want to go on the field, and so I organized a trip for South Africa, Malawi, and Rwanda, and I realized that as much as we could, because they were so powerful, they could never really get to the reality of what was happening. There was these entourages. There was somebody They made the children memorize the national anthem of the European country I will not name, you know. I mean, really uncomfortable things. And so I really felt that with virtual reality, it gives them the sort of dignity and space to share their world, and you can enter it, and that there would be this sort of like communal feeling, even though it's technology, that it would lead to a greater truth, and that's what really motivated me.
Great, thanks. So we're living in the digital era. I heard something interesting this morning. Come here, I want to see you. Those are the first words uttered down the first phone line, and that happened on this day in 1876. So we've come a long way since Alexander Graham Bell. And now with everything on social media, I'd love to hear about, Genevieve, why don't we hear from you first, since you're kind of the youngest on the projection. What did you do? How did you do it? How did you figure it out to work with social media, and how are you having an impact? Because I've seen your website, but talk us through that.
Yeah, absolutely. So it's pretty exciting. Actually, at the beginning of last month, we started beta testing the second version of our website, which I think is a lot more reminiscent of like Instagram and Facebook than, you know, our first variation. What's kind of strange about Slapped is that despite there being a ton of teens out there who have lost a parent, grief in itself is a very, very unspoken topic. So, you know, unlike, you know, many other social causes that are easy to filter through in Google AdWords or in Facebook advertising, you know, you very rarely see hashtag grief. So we've had to be especially clever in how to reach our demographic via social media. It's actually been a little bit more difficult than we would expect. So I think that really the most crucial aspect of social media on our platform is making Slapped a resource that's very intuitive for teens like myself to use. And I think that, you know, in the first variation of our website, you know, being 13 and technologically challenged, I really did reach out to a lot of web developers, and it was a matter of putting as many stories of teens who have lost a parent up on our website and as many bereavement resources as we can find. And through user testing and focus groups and really interacting with teens who've lost a parent themselves and watching their experiences on our website, you know, teens really do gravitate towards a very simple user interface that is like Instagram. You know, you can easily upload a photo of you and your parent. And sort of one aspect of our website that I think really resonates with myself personally is our tribute pages. And I think that it's somewhat like Pinterest, but mostly like Facebook, where you can upload pictures of you and your parent, or pictures of yourself growing up, or pictures of yourself in the day-to-day to sort of memorialize your parent in a way that's private, in a way that you can share, in a way that's really going to last forever on the internet. But in terms of social media, I would say that our most active platform that we use is Facebook. But we're really trying to transition that to Instagram with the second variation of our website. But it actually has been more of a challenge than we expected to be at first.
Thanks. Now, Amani, I know you talked about stigma, and actually Mary mentioned it earlier this morning too. I'm wondering about, so you have the people that are going to relate to what you're talking about. Do you make an effort to go out beyond to people who are confused by you, those people that frustrated you in the first place by not understanding what it's like to be a Muslim and an American at the same time, to be Jersey at once and then to be Muslim as well? How do you reach those people if you indeed try to in your project?
I think that actually a really good number of our audience, it's made up of non-Muslims, people who are outside of our community, outside of our faith, who see Muslim Girl as an approachable and unintimidating resource that's accessible to them so that they can learn about what Islam's about. Because we're not here really talking about the religion itself. We're not here, you know, shoving anything down people's throats. We're literally just having conversations amongst ourselves about the way that we apply Islam to our lifestyles and what that looks like. And I think that that intrigues a lot of people. And for us, you know, we turn to social media to get our voices out there, not as a matter of choice, but as a means of survival. Because for us, social media was literally all we had. It was the only resource that we had available at our fingertips. And I think it is a testament to the power of Muslim women and everything that we stand for, everything that we preach about, that we did, solely using social media, turn this project that was launched out of my bedroom into the first company to land on the Forbes 30 Under 30 list, which is an incredible accomplishment for us. And I do think that part of the power behind that, behind using social media and starting this online, has been that social media eliminates the borders. It eliminates those boundaries. Much like how the United Nations worked with HONI, with Humans of New York, to show people a different lifestyle. You know, you're able to access that. You're able to understand it. You're able to reach people that you otherwise wouldn't be able to reach on, you know, like a telephone or by just print. But instead, you're able to transcend those boundaries. And even more so, social media for us, especially with the topics that we do discuss, sometimes that are contentious, sometimes that are really edgy and that are out there. One beautiful thing that it offers is anonymity. You know, like many of the things that we do talk about on Muslim Girl are very controversial. There are things even internally within the Muslim community that are controversial. For example, we published a personal statement recently by a Muslim woman who chose to remain anonymous, who spoke about the instructor that she had when she was a child, her Quran instructor. A man who was supposed to be teaching her the holy text and how he took advantage of her. And these are topics that are just brushed under the rug a lot of times, but these are things that we choose to take on just as much as we take on Islamophobia and the current political climate. And really, we wouldn't have been able to do that without the power of social media.
Thank you. So Sheila, why don't you talk us through how what Red has done in the digital space and how this revolution has worked with your work with Red?
Well, you know, we have an amazing digital team. I mean, Red is very small. It's like 20 people in New York. And, you know, it's a really dynamic group of people, none of whom, this is not any denigration of the NGO space, but nobody is from the NGO space. People are from the entertainment world, from business, from media. But we've got a small digital team that's really kind of smart and you know, I think at least on top of the curve. But I think it's interesting that, you know, when Red was born, it was 2006, it's the same year that Twitter was born, so we kind of grew up with social media. But the most interesting development for us has been that, you know, in really trying to always, you know, stay on our toes and evolve, is that, you know, when we started Red, and it was kind of one of the first of its kind, you know, products for good, we realized pretty quickly that, you know, we could actually and should move away from just insisting that partners make products, right? And so we have had some really interesting partnerships where we don't have any products at all with some of the partners, but what happens is there is an action digitally that happens that triggers a donation directly to the Global Fund to Fight AIDS, TB, and Malaria. And then that 100% of that money goes to work on the ground for AIDS programs in 8 African countries. But so one of the things we did a couple of years ago with the Chicago Marathon was Bank of America. You know, people could, on their, you know, fitness trackers, track every mile. And when they did, the, you know, Bank of America gave 40 cents, which is the cost of antiretroviral medication daily. And that was really a kind of a smart, kind of beautiful little program. A few years ago, we did something with Foursquare, which you don't hear about so much anymore, but it really increased, you know, foot traffic for Starbucks, which they were really interested in from our partnership. But somebody went into Starbucks that day in Canada or the US. Starbucks gave a dollar to, and they checked in on Foursquare. Starbucks gave a dollar to the Global Fund. But that's also expanded to, you know, with Apple. I mean, some of our most successful partnerships with them right now are in the digital realm. We had the App Store turn red this World AIDS Day and 2 years ago. And that made a lot of money for the Global Fund. You know, the last year, last World AIDS Day in December, it was Games for Red. So, you know, Clash of Clans, Farmville, Angry Birds went red, and it was just really fantastic. There were about 15 games that went red, and the whole app store turned red for, you know, a week leading up to World AIDS Day. It was fantastic. We turned the whole app store red 2 years ago as well. So, look, we see that as an incredible, you know, presence for us globally as well, because we don't have a lot of marketing money, right? So when we can get a partner like Apple to do that in the digital realm. And the one thing I always say as well was when we started, you know, we had 10 miles of Gap windows turn red all around America. But actually, having the App Store turn red is the biggest real estate you can have, you know, in the world, really, from a retail perspective. And so its value is just, you know, exponentially greater than what people remember from kind of seeing on the street, which is also valuable, but moving into the digital realm is really, look, it's a digital world. You know, when people talk about, ooh, we have to think about digital, I mean, that's ridiculous, right? It is a digital world now, and if you're not living in it, you're really not there.
Great, and just on the topic of creating impact, so far Red has raised $465 million for the Global Fund, and 90 million people have been impacted. So you girls are almost there, just a little bit of a step further. And we want to go out to the audience, but just like one quick thing first, and Gabo, we'll start with you, since you kind of talked very clearly in your presentation about impact and how this changes pictures and internalizing. Let's talk about the biggest challenges that you've had and how you've overcome them, because I think one of the aspirations of this five-year project of the Global Health Symposium is kind of to share best practices and hear where people stumbled so that we can all connect and get together to solve those and make innovation easier for those next generation leaders that are following behind us, and you in the audience too. So,
just obstacles in general?
Yeah. Well, obstacles for UNVR.
Yeah.
Oof. You can do in general too, but yeah. I'm not a therapist.
Yeah, no, that's a. I mean, it's definitely not something that was a natural evolution that this new technology would take hold in an organization that's also bureaucratic. I mean, I have a lot of respect for the UN, and I think it's very important, and we must defend it in these times. But we also must be self-critical, and for me. I just, the biggest obstacles have been older people who, you know, are not...
Older people?
who,
just in general?
No, but, you know, more senior people who are not necessarily as with it, you know, and I think it just takes.
I think there's a big insult. That was
no,
a,
I didn't mean.
That was a
I didn't mean it like
insult.
That. But, no, but they're very supportive now, and it's great. But it really has. And the biggest challenges have been to take risks, because there's going to be an incredible amount of risks, and there's going to be failure. There's going to be a lot of things that go wrong when you do a partnership with Humans of New York, and you know he ends up in like Jerusalem and he's not supposed to be there or something like that, you know, or and then he's in Iraq and with a lot of the VR films in the beginning, there just wasn't an understanding. I mean, we have a film we've done on Gaza, it's called My Mother's Wing, and you know, it's not easy to do these types of very difficult stories. But I will say that, you know, it is an education process, and I think slowly, you know, people come around to it. But it is, you have to be willing to take a lot of risks. You have to put your reputation on the line, because there are going to be people who are always going to be incredibly scared by changing the status quo. And so that's the best thing you can, you know, we have to do that.
Okay, great. Amani, your biggest obstacle or challenge?
I think that right now, probably our biggest obstacle would have to be the commodification of Muslim women that we're seeing taking place right now. And it's really interesting, right? It's so interesting because it really just delves into the nuance of tokenization in today's world. It's like representation, visibility, these are things that we as Muslim women have been struggling for, really for the greater part of the past two decades. And now you see over the past 2 years, just, you know, the surge in people wanting to talk about Muslim women, you know, like the headlines, brands, you know, Nike just announced that they're going to be designing a athletic hijab, right? And all these things are happening. But the thing is it's really important for us to make sure that this is a moment of empowerment for Muslim women rather than one of exploitation, right? We don't want people to just piggyback off of the hard work of Muslim women, all the things that we've done to get here, and then just try to cash in on it instead of harnessing Muslim women into the process and empowering them, giving back to the community, right? Like when we see all these brands wanting to, you know, include like a Muslim woman's face in their ad campaign because they know it'll go viral if they do that, and they'll get more PR than they could possibly pay for. And yet, you know, when we see Donald Trump making statements about banning all Muslims from the country, not a single one of these brands will stand up for us and say we stand with Muslims and this is unacceptable. And so I think that right now it's a very opportune moment. Just this International Women's Day, 2 days ago, we were very proud to announce our new partnership with Getty Images. We just launched a new stock photo collection of Muslim women to diversify the representation of Muslim women in the digital space. Because all you typically see are women hidden behind black veils. It's very dark, very bleak, very negative, and it doesn't look anything like us, right? Like, does it look like me?
Absolutely
no.
Absolutely not.
So we wanted to change that, and I think the thing that is the most beautiful about it was that through this partnership, we were able to put a Muslim woman photographer in charge of it, to be the one to see Muslim women through her lens. We made sure that all of the models were Muslim women, and all of the models were authentic, right? Like, we included women that wear the headscarf and women that don't wear the headscarf, because another stereotype is that all Muslim women cover it, and they don't. And all the girls that are in there, none of them are playing dress up, none of them are acting, they're all really just being themselves. And really, this is going to make a new, very diverse representation of Muslim women available to journalists and media heads around the world now, very instantaneously. And I think that it really is just one step in this greater picture that we're looking at right now about how we're going to make the world a more inclusive place of people that might look different than us.
They might have been old people taking those photos. Genevieve,
no,
you're working in such a sensitive area, and I've met Genevieve a few times, and we've been on calls, and she's working in this space that's kind of an unspoken topic for so many people, grief, and that in and of itself is such a huge challenge. And not only is it a challenge in the space, but you're also dealing with your own grief through all of this as a young woman. So I'm sure there's that aspect of it that that's huge for you. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that on a personal note, you know, I think that Slapped really did give me sort of the greatest remedy to battling grief, per se, and that was purpose. But it doesn't take away from the fact that, you know, my dad was, you know, someone who understood me like no one else. I was so close to my dad growing up, and I also have two younger siblings. You know, my sister was 7, my brother was 10. And I have a strong alpha dog of a mom, but it was so hard for my family. And I think that that actually represents one of the greatest challenges with Slapped, and that is that we have thousands of kids that come onto our website that are, you know, suffering from all different types of grief and all different types of parent loss. You know, my father died suddenly, but we have kids whose parents die from cancer, kids whose parents die from suicide, which is, you know, another beast in itself, and how to sort of find that commonality. But also, these are vulnerable individuals that are coming onto our website. And, you know, one of our greatest challenges with the first website was monitoring that and ensuring that there wasn't any type of, you know, cyberbullying, and that each of, you know, our users were safe using our platform. And actually, you know, within our first website, we were extremely restricted, especially by COPA, which is the Child Online Protection Act, which, first of all, sort of delineates, you know, an age limit for kids who are, you know, on social media, but also the type of monitoring that's needed. And I think one of the greatest developments of our second website was generating the funding so that we could have bereavement specialists monitoring our website and the forum activity of, you know, these different teens. But, you know, another issue in itself has also been integrating the bereavement world, which, you know, I remember after my, you know, father died, my mom, you know, telling me to, or encouraging me to talk to someone, and the stigma behind that as well. I think, first of all, I'm someone that doesn't like to receive help in the first place, but I also knew that I wasn't ready to confront how I was feeling, and, you know, I felt atypical, and no one at 13 wants to feel that way. But one of Slapp's, you know, primary goals is to bring bereavement services to teens who have lost a parent, especially within lower socioeconomic areas. And one of our new primary developments has been the creation of the center pages. The way that the bereavement landscape sort of works now is, despite there being hundreds of bereavement centers that are linked through the National Alliance of Grieving Children, Many of them are underfunded, they don't have their own websites. It's extremely difficult to seek out these bereavement services that do have their own resources but aren't exactly reaching the demographic that they want to organically. And so through our website and through these center pages, you know, we provide a place for bereavement centers to share a little bit about themselves and their specialists, you know, resources within our users' vicinity, and, you know, online resources that, you know, our users can use. Also, you know, a newer partnership that we've actually created with is with the Dave and Cheryl Goldberg Foundation. And with the Sandberg Foundation and Sheryl Sandberg's new book, Option B, after her husband Dave's sudden death, she also has two young children. It's really about resilience, you know, not just after the loss of a loved one, but also after any type of tragedy. And the idea of storytelling, and through their foundation and in our new partnership, we are going to be creating an index, and SLAPT will be in the picture more creating an index for teens who have lost a parent through that foundation and through their website. So really, one of the difficulties is bringing teens who have lost a parent to our platform so that they know, you know, that they're, you know, that their stories are unique, but, you know, their situations are not, and they're not alone through this grieving process.
Great. Well, congrats on that partnership. I think anyone would be happy to have a partnership with Sheryl Sandberg. So good for you. We're thrilled at how many people that'll affect. So Sheila, I'll go to you before we go to the audience. I've heard you tell a story once about, I think you were in Louisiana, and it was a red event. Not Louisiana? You've never been to Louisiana? And it was a red event, and it was one of the first ones that you did when Bono wasn't there. And you looked out into the audience, and it was full of people, and you turned around, and you realized that it was you and a red product, and without the celebrity there in the audience. So I'm sure that might have been one of the beginning ones. Am I making that story up?
Yes.
Oh.
I now remember what it was. We were launching with Starbucks, and it was in New Orleans, so you're right about
it. New Orleans, okay.
Yeah, but Bono was there, and but it was, you know, Howard Schultz had brought 10,000 employees to this venue, and they were doing Habitats for Humanity as well, you know, in New Orleans. It was asked after Hurricane Katrina, but he was announcing some, you know, new kind of pro-social initiatives, and Bono was behind the curtain. I'm standing there with him, and at the very beginning, setting up Red, our intention always was to make Red the celebrity, right? Not to have it be dependent on him or necessarily other celebrities, although we do use them to propagate our message and to make money. But anyway, Howard Schultz announces to all the employees that they're going to be Red, right? And it was incredible because the entire arena stood up. They all gave a standing ovation. But none of them knew Bono was there. And it was just this moment where it was like, oh, you're not needed. Oh, sorry. Yeah, no, I'm not needed. That's brilliant, right? Because it actually was kind of year four or something. We realized, okay, we were actually on the right path, right? Because it was itself becoming a celebrity. And that was a really kind of great thing. So that was it.
There was some truth to the story. It's nice when you can just tell Bono, it's okay, I got this, right? Okay, let's go out to the audience. We do have mics all over, actually, so please just raise your arm, make sure your question's a question, and wait for the mic. Okay, right here, the lady on table three, please. 1 second, our intern is winding her way through. If you'd like to identify yourself, too, you may.
Thank you. Hi, my name's Alice Albright, and I work in the education space. What wonderful work you all do. In a spirit of sort of connecting the dots, I know the last panel we talked about the limited reach of health systems in many places. My organization works on the limited reach of education systems in many poor countries. And I'd love to get your thoughts on how you think social media can begin to overcome some of the distance and some of the isolation issues that affect both the delivery of health and education in some of the poorest countries. And again, congratulations on the work that you all are doing.
Gabo, do you want to take that one since you're kind of at the cutting edge with the VR?
Yeah. So we have a project that's just, you know, with community healthcare workers that very much at its infancy about improving, and someone had mentioned that in the panel before about the education of some of the health workers and the trainings. And so, you know, we're looking at this of how we can use certain VR trainings to get them to better do what they need to do. Because in a lot of the studies of community healthcare workers, there's a bit of a gap there. And so virtual reality, I mean, you've mentioned social media, but you know, virtual reality eventually will have the ability, because in your phones, you all have the ability to watch virtual reality. Not in the most immersive way, but if you have a Google Cardboard, and then if you have another headset. So eventually this is going to be something that will be powerful, where people who are in rural areas will not necessarily be disconnected. I mean, you know, and so there are still challenges with connectivity and other things that we have to do, you know, with what Facebook does with internet.org. So I think, you know, we're looking into that because a lot of the studies are showing that when people experience trainings in an immersive environment, it's stickier and it's more effective. And these are very early days to measure that, but a lot of the results are encouraging. And if you just look at if people are watching this, we have to see how much of it is a wow factor and that it's new, and how much of it is actually going to result and make a difference. So a lot of those studies are underway, but they're very promising. And I think if we bring some elements of that, and not just storytelling, but training and everything, it's going to be, it could make a big difference, I think.
The other day, I gave a talk to a classroom in Orlando from my home in Brooklyn, New York, you know, like just through the webcam. And I think that is something that's so easily translatable, you know, internationally. I think that really there are no limits with the way that social media can help, you know, just export education around the world. And, you know, there are things like online classes that are already available, online materials and stuff like that. But really, it's quite remarkable that we can have that type of connection, that access, you know, from one side of the world to the other, that instantaneously. And I think that it really does show that there is a bright future ahead if we are able to successfully harness these technologies for the greater good.
Great, thank you. We've got a question from Conference.io, Sheila, that I think you might be interesting to hear your response. How do you avoid being condescending in offering assistance?
Well, you know, I think that's a really good question. And to Gabo's point, you know, I think that that's what you were hitting on here. I mean, really kind of getting people to be immersed in a real experience, right? You know, I had an argument, well, number of arguments a number of years ago, but we realized that nobody had told so far the story of people being impacted by, you know, intervention, global intervention in the AIDS sphere. And so I took all of Red's marketing money that year, which is tiny, and we made a documentary called The Lazarus Effect with, you know, Spike Jones helped us produce it and gave us the director and everything. But, you know, the typical question, and this never comes from Bono or anybody like this, but, you know, was, oh, you have to have a celebrity telling the story. You have to have somebody who's going to narrate it or somebody from the West. And I was absolutely... you know, definitely not going to do that. We wanted the story to be told by people who were going through the experience. And that really kind of stood up, right? Because maybe we didn't get a huge bells and whistles, you know, launch away, but we were able to get it on HBO. We got a perfectly good launch. It was fantastic. We did something at MoMA. It was just wonderful. And it really has stood the test of time, though, and Apple put it up on its Apple Docs recently, the last World AIDS Day, because precisely that, right? We did not condescend to people. And, you know, and I think that it's been something, I can just speak from my own experience, something that we've been very adhere to at Red, because I think that we're just attuned to, you know, the how horrifying it can be, especially when you put a celebrity in a situation where it's, you know, this appeal that feels as if they're feeling the pain of the person who's actually going through the pain. And you know what? We're not going through the pain. So don't try to represent that, I feel, because I think that that potentially devalues the actual experience that the people are going through. And you know, I think that the world is getting better and better about that, because I think that maybe social media has done this, but, you know, Oh, God, what am I talking about? I was just going to say that it kind of flushes out inauthenticity. No, it doesn't at all. I've just realized the time we're living in and how it's actually, there's a kind of war of, you know, truth versus lies. But I have faith that truth will out in the end, right? Because it is a universal truth. And I think that that's really what we're talking about, about how you kind of tell stories and keep it authentic.
That's right. How about one of the next gen from the audience? We'd love to hear from you. What questions do you have? If you could raise your arms, please. No. Oh, right over here. Look, this lady here in the blue dress, please.
Hi. Thank you all so much for sharing your experiences with us. And in that spirit of wanting to share stories and to, you know, make sure we're not being condescending and offering assistance, do you think that social media has the power to bridge the gap between the us and the them to make sure that, you know, the NGOs, the institutions that we work for are really, you know, being built up with our the clients that we're aiming to serve, that people, you know, are empowered themselves to become and to lead, you know, in the ways that they know are most effective to have an impact on their community?
Genevieve, would you take that one,
yeah,
please?
Absolutely. So sort of SLAPP's theory of change is that, you know, individuals who've lost a parent are, you know, referred onto the website. And we've seen a lot through user activity that at the beginning it's more of a browsing. They create up a user page, but they don't create their own memorial until, you know, a couple of weeks when they start to integrate onto the website and ultimately become the resource for others and then refer the website again. And I do think that sort of echoing sort of what Amani was saying about this idea of anonymity. I think that social media, especially, you know, in the field of grief, has allowed teens to more easily vocalize, you know, the experiences that they're going through. And also, you know, SLAPP really did grow from a social innovation standpoint as opposed to, you know, sort of the traditional nonprofit route. And despite sort of being a 501c3, you know, through incubators such as actually Matter from the last panel, as well as, you know, the Social New Venture Challenge at the business school, although we haven't had, you know, as much of a global reach yet, especially because we are only in English, hopefully Spanish soon, but although we are only now, you know, in English, sort of coordinating with these other, you know, social innovations to sort of bring our resource to teens who've lost a parent everywhere. Actually, there's this amazing social innovation called by Daniel Yu, and it's called Relief Watch. And essentially, you know, within agrarian communities, especially in the developing world, you know, these farmers often won't have local medicine, but they'll be able to, they'll have cell phones, and they can, you know, text in to get the medicine flown to where they need it. And we, you know, in the future, I was actually talking with SLAPP's COO the other day about somehow disseminating our literature or even, you know, a non-virtual package to be sent over to these communities that have experienced, you know, parent loss. So I think that social media, you know, among beyond sort of its anonymity will help, you know, bring our resources to teens who've lost a parent, you know, not just in the United States, but also, you know, in the global community.
Amani, did you want to talk about that too, or you feel like you covered it?
I can't build more off of that.
Okay, wonderful. All right, anybody else out in the audience, please? Okay, oh, I see one back there. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Michaela, and I'm a student in health sciences at DePaul University here in Chicago. And my question was, I know you sort of told your stories about how you came to the ideas that you had, but without a jumping off point like involvement with the UN or Bono or some other celebrity, how do you get your message out there? Just, I know you talked about expansion just now, but when it's just you in your bedroom with an idea, where do you go from there?
Where do you go?
I mean, exactly. One thing that people don't know about Muslim Girl is that we've been working on it for 7 years. It's been 7 years of this work, and Muslim Girl just started blowing up maybe a year or two ago. But that's the point, is that it takes a lot of hard work, and if it does start with a single individual, it is going to take, you know, building it up from the very first founding block. For us, you know, I was very lucky to be surrounded by incredible women, other Muslim girls like myself, who felt just as strongly about this as I did. You know, like tapping into people who are just as passionate about your cause as you is super crucial. These are women that really have poured their blood, sweat, and tears into this project as a labor of love because of how much they believed in it. And Muslim Girl would literally not be anywhere where it is today if it weren't for those people. And then, of course, reaching out to allies, people that might not necessarily be the ones that are part of the project that you're doing or the people that you're trying to reach with your project, but who also believe in it and who can support it and bring resources to the table, whether that's guidance and advice or otherwise. But it really is important to build up those teams and, you know, to stay persistent, because the thing is everyone always sees the glory that's on social media. They see the shine and the glitz and the glam and stuff of the things that we're doing, but they never see all the sleepless nights that led to us getting there. They don't see all the sacrifice, the pain, the many times where I was in tears, like, oh my God, is this really gonna work? Or should I just like stop right now? But yeah, people don't really see that. I personally almost became homeless because of Muslim Girl, because I poured literally every penny that I had into this and I couldn't afford rent anymore. And it was only 1 month later that Muslim Girl got its first investor. So you never know when that moment's gonna come, but it really does take a lot of dedication and persistence and really just reaching out to the people that you need the help from.
Genevieve.
Oh, you're so goals, but sort of, you know, going forward, I was 13 after my dad died, and, you know, I'm not going to lie, I think that I was extremely lucky with the community that, you know, I was surrounded with, especially my mom, who, and, you know, my aunt and my uncle, and the people that really believed in me since the beginning, and I think they really, the women around me that supported me to be, you know, I think the girl that I am or the woman that I am, you know, someone who's never really at a loss for words and someone who wanted to sort of spread their narrative towards, you know, this greater goal. And I think that the greatest advice that I had gotten, you know, without any money to sort of propel Slapped Forward, except for, you know, my mom's generosity, was to really ask people and, you know, harness the strength of a community. I mean, I remember the first person that I talked to was a woman named Star Marcello at, you know, the Chicago Booth School, which is sort of right around the corner of my house, but I had never set foot in. My mom didn't really know anyone there, but I had a high school English teacher that said, you know, my wife works at the Polsky Center, and they harness all types of new innovation. You should just stop in there one day. And here's my wife's email. So I shot her an email. I had my mom proofread it a few times. And, you know, one day after school, I went over to the Polsky Center. And Star, you know, an extraordinarily strong woman and social innovator herself, said, you know, this is an idea with potential. And you know, Slapped has gone through many, many iterations. So it wasn't the social media for teens who had lost a parent yet. You know, it went from a blog, it went from, you know, a place to share pictures. You know, it's gone through many iterations, but Star really helped me make that idea cohesive and helped me sort of, you know, consolidate the, you know, Slapped's pitch so I could reach out to web developers and investors to sort of grow Slapped Forward. Another thing that's really helped are, you know, online crowdfunding platforms such as Indiegogo that we used last year and raised, you know, over $50,000 just through creating videos, pinging people on social media. So I think really to get that momentum starting is through telling people about your idea and asking for help. Because I think a lot of the things that have benefited Slapped so much are people's generosity and asking for help in the first place.
Okay, so I love the last question. That is the most popular question on our online question platform. It's only a sentence for each of you, don't worry, but let's just remind ourselves that this panel is about mobilizing ideas and creating impact, and because you four are so inspirational, our audience wants to know, what story or issue do you feel the world needs to hear most? And I'm assuming that means outside of what they're already talking about. So is there something else, just a sentence or something in the world, because our audience wants to learn and go out and create impact on that, I'm sure. Who wants to go first? Gabo, you want to go first?
No.
Because gentlemen go first.
That's a tough one.
All right, Sheila, will you go first?
I always hate those. Describe in one word or give one sentence.
Okay, you can have like six words. It's okay.
No, my sentence would be, I mean, something I'm just obsessed about at the moment. I think I don't know how on earth we make this happen, but I do think some regard for truth, investigative journalism, is the most important thing right now in the world, or one of the most important things, apart from the environment.
Okay, she got two in, the environment and truth and journalism. We can do a clapometer. Genevieve.
That's such a hard question. I think the first thing that I've been reading a lot about is the idea of caregiverism and feminism that transcends simply women in the workplace, but the power of women that stay at home and take care of their children, because I imagine that's of the hardest jobs. And I think that feminism really comes down to empowering other women, regardless of the choices that they make. So
excellent.
I think that
we'll give that one a big clap too. Gabo.
Yeah. You know, I think a lot about storytelling, and I think about climate change a lot and how to make it more relevant. And I think its relationship to everything is going to be, like I was reading about the Sahel region, and just we know how much climate change and extreme weather is going to affect the next migration or the next sort of refugee crisis. And just kind of putting a name and a place and a face to what our inaction is about, I think, and being creative about it is very important, because it is still something that no matter if we solve everything else, you know, we're going to be in big trouble. So
certainly, that's right. On the environment. Amani.
God, this is, yeah, it's such a hard question. I would say that the issue that I feel is one that could potentially resolve a lot of issues in the world is focusing on who is the one telling the story, and passing the mic where necessary, right? I think that it is crucial for us to empower communities to speak on their own behalf rather than have others speak up for them or tell their story for them or tell them what's best for them. But I think that it's really important for us to be responsible in the type of content that we consume. You know, if we're reading stories about a certain religious, cultural, whatever community, then to read those resources from that community itself that was written by them, that was told by them. And I think that if we do learn to pass the mic, symbolically or otherwise, then that could really clarify a lot of misunderstandings for us.
Most definitely, thank you. So let me just get through a bit of housekeeping before we fully thank our panel. One person I want to thank, who unfortunately I think had to leave, is Fumi Olapadi. Unfortunately, Zora Yusufu called us from the Amsterdam KLM lounge on Wednesday and found out that her daughter had had an accident. The daughter's okay, but she had to fly back to Lagos. And I called Fumi, who is just a powerhouse from the south side of Chicago to the north part of Nigeria, the world over. She's amazing. She said something, one of the smartest things that we heard here in a very pithy way 2 years ago, that where you live shouldn't determine whether you live. And I think that her work and her voice definitely speaks to that. So we're eternally grateful for a busy woman like her to come and participate. So thank you on live stream, Fumi, for that. Amani has a book out. It's going to be for sale downstairs on the second floor. It's called Muslim Girl, A Coming of Age. And now you've got a choice between two terrific breakout sessions down on the second floor. We know everyone wants to network and connect. We encourage you to carefully and briskly walk down the stairs without networking and get there safely. In the living room, we're talking about how education is the most powerful investment and the importance of technology in delivering access and inclusive education. And in the grill room, we're talking about how can we improve gender equality by engaging men and boys? And at 12:15, we'll be back up here for a lunch with the terrific woman, Elizabeth Dozier from Fenger High School. I look forward to seeing you back then. And now let's join in a massive round of applause for this inspiring, inspiring panel. Thank you.